Hey guys, Zoli here. This video will consist of two parts. The first half is going to be a quick guide on how to operate my vehicles, while the second half will focus on the different types of vehicles, weapons and ammunition. I do recommend watching both parts of the video, but if you've already seen this half or want to skip to the second half, here's the timestamp. You can find the link to the mod page in the video description below. First things first, my vehicles use an integrated display system that many players seem to have issues with. 95% of the time it comes down to the user not reading the mod description or checking the Q&A section, so I've included this in the video as well. In order for the displays to work properly, you need to set your render method to deferred. To do this, open the pause menu, click on graphics, scroll all the way to the bottom, and select deferred. Besides this, there shouldn't be any other settings you need to change. But if the displays still don't work properly, try changing your scope settings. Contrary to vanilla vehicles, mine use a manually controlled engine system. By default, the engine is turned off, so the vehicle can't move, turn, or use the integrated systems. To turn on the engine, press your sirens key, by default left control, and wait a few seconds for the engine to start up. Pressing control again will turn off the engine and all integrated systems. To move the vehicle, use the default movement keys, W and S, and to turn, use A and D. You'll notice that the vehicle is also capable of turning on the spot. One thing to note, do not touch the steering keys while your engine is starting up, or your vehicle will be stuck turning to one side. If you do this by mistake, simply release the steering key and restart the engine to fix it. Moving on, you can see three options pop up on your screen when you get close to the vehicle. Each one of these enables one of the integrated systems. The driver and gunner selections also enable third-person mode. You need the engine to be running for it to work though. To select an option, hold your default expressions key, in my case C, and click on the respective option. Once you've selected something, the corresponding buttons and screens will show up. If you want to reset your selection, you can do so by clicking on the system selection overlay button or simply exiting the vehicle. These selections work client-side, which means that your selections won't influence the selections of other players. This helps minimize performance impact on multiplayer and limits each system's performance drain to the player using it. There's also a failsafe implemented, which fires every time you exit the vehicle. This resets your system selection and all elements to their default state, so you don't have to turn off anything when you exit the vehicle. This helps minimize performance drain when outside the vehicle. The driver's HUD consists of four displays: the front view optics, the rear view optics, the GPS, and the self-sensor display. The GPS comes with two levels of magnification. You can switch the system into night mode, which enables NVD for the main optics and the GPS. During daytime, it's not recommended to have it enabled. On certain vehicles, the sensor HUD will also detect laser signatures from incoming guided missiles, and shows them with a red line across your display. Out of these four displays, the sensor HUD has the least impact on performance, followed by the GPS, the reverse camera, and lastly, the main optics. You might notice that you have a weapon equipped. This serves no purpose at the moment. You can't fire or damage anything with it. It's merely there to allow the driver to zoom in and better see the screens. Next is the gunner's HUD. This consists of three displays, namely the main gunner's optic, the rangefinder, and the self-sensor display. This also comes equipped with night vision, and the main optic gets access to thermal imaging FLIR mode. FLIR highlights all heat sources, while displays everything else in grey. This is best used for locating targets, as your sense of your surroundings is close to non-existent. It's recommended to use the default or night vision mode for actual engagements. Performance-wise, the self-sensor has the least impact, the rangefinder is the second one, and the main optic has the highest impact. The way you use the ballistic computer is quite simple. You point your rangefinder cross at your target. It will display the exact range on the top of your screen, then you select the closest value on the range pad. The computer compensates for shell drop and deviation, so even if your vehicle is sideways, as long as you range correctly, you will be hitting exactly where you aim. The next seat is the commander seat. It consists of the CITV display in the middle, a short-range area radar top right, short-range directional radar under it, GPS display to the top left, and a self-sensor display under it. The radars will display living creatures except players with an image feed that updates once every second. Their detection radius is 100 meters. The commander can freely look around using his independent commander sight, which also has access to night vision and FLIR. This is partially stabilized, meaning that no matter how the turret rotates, the optic will still point to the same direction. The commander also has access to the smoke screening system, which can be used a total of 2 times before needing to reload. It creates a smoke cloud in a 360-degree radius around the vehicle. When it comes down to performance impact, the self-sensor and the radars are mostly on the same level, followed by the GPS, and lastly the main optic, which impacts your performance the most. The last seat is the assistant gunner seat. It's the simplest of them all, as it consists of a remotely operated weapon or weapon system. This covers the first half of the video. The second half will focus on the differences between the vehicles, weapons, ammunition, and some other things. First off, currently there are 4 different models of Leopard tanks. These come in 2 base color variants, namely Olive Green and Desert Tan, and one 4S CARC camouflage variant. The Leopard 2A4 is your entry-level main battle tank. It has the least amount of protection out of all 4, with a total HP of 1800 points. It's armed with the Rheinmetall L44 120mm smoothbore cannon. It has access to 6 different types of kinetic energy anti-tank shells, 1 fragmentation shell and 1 chemical energy anti-tank shell. The commander's optic is placed in front of his cupola, however it lacks FLIR. The assistant gunner gets access to the MG3A1 general purpose machine gun. This one comes equipped with a 200 round magazine by default. Next up is the Leopard 2A5. The main difference between this and the previous model is the redesigned turret. The optic has been moved above the turret roof, removing a major weak spot, and the turret has been reinforced both internally and externally with extra armor panels. The hull of the vehicle also received better armor as well as new side skirts, thus boosting the vehicle HP to 2000 points. The commander's optic has been moved and raised behind the cupola and received FLIR sights. The third vehicle, namely the Leopard 2A6, is an upgrade to the 2A5. It received the Rheinmetall L55 120mm smoothbore cannon. Due to the longer barrel, all projectiles fired from this cannon gain increased velocity and their damage is increased by 20%. The vehicle retains the same stats as the previous model. The 2A7 Plus is the latest and most modern of all vehicles. It's essentially a 2A6 variant, upgraded with extra protection internally and new composite armor panels externally, boosting the hit points to 2200 points. Remote-controlled 50 caliber heavy machine gun has also been installed on the turret. The 2A7 Plus was designed with urban warfare in mind. It's also the first vehicle to feature laser warning. The self-sensor system has been upgraded to detect the laser signature from guided missiles and displayed with bright red to warn the crew. Now that we covered all of the tanks, let's take a look at the weapons and ammunition. Each vehicle can use all of the available shells, but depending on which cannon they are being fired from, their damage and velocity changes. There are 6 types of kinetic energy penetrators. The only difference between them is damage. DM63 has the highest damage and DM13 has the lowest. The stat cards of all items have been made to show information like this. DM12 Heat is a chemical energy penetrator. Therefore, it has lower damage than DM13, but it's more useful as an anti-infantry round. DM11 is the latest shell developed for the tank. It's a high explosive fragmentation shell designed with only one purpose in mind, mass destruction. It's most effective against infantry or cover, as it has a large explosion and fragmentation radius dealing damage in a 30-meter area around the impact point. Moving on, the 50 cal fires a massive bullet capable of penetrating armor and cover. It's also very effective against infantry. Taking even one hit to the torso can be fatal. The MG3A1 on the other hand is a lower caliber machine gun, but what it loses in destructive power makes up for in fire rate. For the time being, you can use high and low caliber military ammo boxes to refill these magazines. In the future, these will be replaced by custom ammo crates of different caliber. This ended up being a pretty long video, so if you've made it this far, thanks for watching, have fun, and I'll see you next time!